Americans have always stood at the crossroads of the fight for freedom. It is a battle in which we all reap the benefits. World War II was the defining event of the 20th century. It involved 60 countries. Over 57 million people were killed. The nuclear age was launched, and the United States emerged as the world's most powerful nation. World War II was fought in two major theaters of operation, the North African, Mideastern, and European theater, and to the Far East, the Asiatic Pacific theater. During World War II, thousands of ships were built for the war effort. This is the story of one of them.
I first saw it in 1943, and I was amazed because I was 17 and right out of boot camp, and I loved the ship. Love at first sight, you know. It's a beautiful ship.
I was just amazed. I just couldn't fathom something being this huge out in the water, you know, and being able to not sink.
I looked at that ship. I thought, this is the ship I want on. Nothing can hit this, baby. Was I surprised.
It was in Newport News Shipbuilding Dry Dock Company being fitted out. And so after the ship was commissioned, that is, it was finished, and the crew was on board, most of our crew were raw recruits right out of Great Lakes.
We took off from Newport News and out into the Atlantic to take a convoy over to Africa. And I guess I was just kind of overwhelmed.
And then we were sent over to the Mediterranean to support the landings in Sicily, which was our first combat action. And we were bombarding positions on the shore. The ship suffered its first casualty then, though, because we had a spotting plane, and it was being flown over to help spot the gunfire, and it was attacked by German fighters, and the pilot made it back to the ship all right, and he landed and taxied up to the ship and turned around so the rear seat man could put a hook onto the plane to hoist it back aboard, and he looked back and didn't see any rear seat man there. There were some bullet holes found back there, and they think he must have been hit and then fallen out. That was the only casualty we had at that time. That was the beginning.
We got a message, and Patton's armored forces had outrun their supply train, and the Birmingham got orders to land 2,000 Spam sandwiches on the beach for Patton's armored forces, because they had outrun their supply train and were going hungry. So the Birmingham put two or three whaleboats over the side with 2,000 Spam sandwiches.
From Sicily to Norfolk, through the canal, to Pearl Harbor, to Wake Island, and then we went south, down in the South Pacific, and in the Solomon Island area. Then Bougainville was the next big island that we had to take in this stepping stone effect that we had, we were going to use to go to Japan. I saw a formation of planes. General quarters went.
General quarters, all hands man your battle station.
It wasn't long until we are belly deep in jet planes. I knew that we'd been hit forward. We went up, 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 up forever. Now we go down, down, down forever. We've already cut a groove in the water, so we're sinking. We're going to the bottom of the ocean. I was never as scared in my life.
We could hear the guns, 5-inch guns firing, and then the 40 millimeter started, and we knew something was getting close. And I heard through the headphone, I heard Sam yell, "Here comes a fish." We looked at each other and waited. Nobody broke, nobody panicked, nothing. We just waited. And suddenly there was a and the whole ship shuddered. And we looked around at the bulkheads and no water was coming in. I thought, well, maybe we're all right. About 5 minutes later, another hit, torpedo hit. This one was aft, just below the hangar deck. And the first one, and later on, about half an hour after that, we had a bomb. A Japanese plane dropped a bomb that hit on one of the after turrets. Well, out of that, we probably lost 20 people.
And when we took that aerial torpedo, it knocked the electric out right in there. We flipped on them battle lamps, you know. We had a gunner's mate, and he says, "Ha ha," he says, "I think we're sinking." Scared me to death and all the rest of them in there too. No lights, no air in there. But we got back, we made it through it.
The ship could still steam, still shoot, and we were able to stay in the battle.
Those two torpedoes, the guardian angels arranged for them to go through that ship in the only two places you could put a torpedo in a Cleveland-class cruiser and not blow it up.
We then took one of the deck portals going down into a lot of that storage space up forward, and it took the cover off of that and allowed that every time the bow would pitch, there'd be a spray like Old Faithful would come up, and we looked like Yellowstone National Park. But that did relieve any pressure as the bow would pitch.
We were in that dry dock. I heard this voice behind me, and it said it must have been a busy Thursday night. And in a typical good military fashion, I said, "Buddy, you ain't just whistling Dixie." And I turned around, and all I could see were stars. There were four on each collar. And it was Admiral Nimitz. I'd never met the Admiral. He, of course, the boss of the Pacific Fleet.
We were amused later on to hear Tokyo Rose announce that they had sunk the Birmingham.
It was a cloudy day. Some plane came out of one of those clouds and dropped a bomb on the Princeton. And we were told after that to drop back and take care of the Princeton, see if you could put the fire out and get it underway again.
I got topside and looked over that Princeton. It was burning real good, and I could see the aft end there. It just looked like it's kind of red hot. So I sit down and underneath the number 3 turret. Wouldn't it be a hell of a thing if that boat would blow up? And the next thing I knew, I was on my face in the deck. For the next 7.5 months, I didn't stand up. I thought I was the only guy that survived back there in that after deck. I find out that there was one other fella that survived from back there. In his article, he said that there were 300 of them back there, and he only saw one living person. That was me. I thought I was all alone. But I survived.
And all of a sudden, an enormous explosion, and shrapnel went everywhere. We, our people, our ship, was riddled up in the top side. We had about 220 people killed, just like that, in an instant. Another 300 some odd were wounded. I had some shrapnel in my face. The captain was wounded badly also. We had one medical officer at the time. He said, I looked at you that first day, John, and I said, he's not going to make it, so I leave him alone, try to save the people I can save. And he said he came back about 24 hours later, looked again, he said, son of a gun, he's still alive. Maybe we can save him.
Well, I was very lucky. I was up there watching the action as they were coming in, and I was with my boss, who was Commander Perkins, and 80, Lieutenant 80, who was in my division. And for some reason, I don't know why, I said, I think I'll go down below, because we were not at general quarters. In fact, a lot of people up there were sightseers. So I went down the ladder, and I was not down there more than a minute or two till they exploded. And there were bodies and pieces of bodies all over, and blood running in the gutters, and it was horrible.
When the explosion, the outburst from the explosion came, I was standing looking right straight at it along with another fellow. And of course, you see it, but you don't have time to do anything. All that thrash and water hit me in the face, and I thought I'd been blinded. But I got back out there, and I was able to clear my eyes and start taking inventory to see what else had happened. I'm sore all over. And then about that time, they led us back to a first aid station. At that time was the officer's mess quarters. And where I was sitting was behind a curtain. And I couldn't see the people inside where the bad stuff was, or bad injuries, I should say. After sitting there a while, I got to checking around and see what was wrong. I had a sore mouth and a sore finger and a few things. I'd taken a piece of shrapnel in my on my face right about here, knocked a shattered one tooth and one on my finger down here, plus numerous others. But when I looked out, pulled the curtain back, it seemed like it was a half hour, but it was probably over 2 or 3 minutes. What I saw was, I said, there was nothing wrong with me. I said that to myself, or I may have said it out loud. So I got up and got out of there. I said, I didn't need to be in here wasting their time, because it was terrible.
When that exploded, it knocked me down. And I jumped up and I ran under the 6-inch guns, because stuff was still falling. And then I turned to walk down the deck, go back to my compartment. And I passed the friend of mine, and he says, I think you've been wounded, Walton. I says, where? He says, in the back. I says, you're kidding. No. But all of a sudden it started hurting, and I lost all control of my arm. It took us 4 days to get to a hospital ship. And I was on there 4 days, and the doctor kept saying, did they x-ray you yet? I said, no, sir. The fourth day, he says, you come with me. And he took me up to the x-ray. He developed the x-ray, took me in the operating room. When I woke up, this was tied around my neck with a piece of gauze, the spark plug. It weighs 3/4 pound, and it's pretty close to 3.5 inches long. So put me in a hospital for 9 months. And the man on the right, his name was Staymates, he got killed. And the guy on my left, I asked about him, well, he got a black eye, and I got the spark plug. Everyone I knew got killed, you know, in our division. All the ones I loafed with, they all got killed.
Everything just went up. I mean, you felt like you were right in a ball of fire. The whole side of the ship was like you take a shotgun and at close range hit a target. I mean, that whole side of the ship, big holes, little holes, everything. Everybody on the ship, on that side of the ship, were immediately killed or injured. It's just like rain, only it was red hot metal. Just fell It was shot in the air and just fell all over the ship. I was right at the, on that side. I dropped and that probably saved me. I don't know what saved me. But I dropped, and the only thing I could think of was going over the side, because I thought I was injured that bad in my mind. As far as I was concerned, I wanted to be buried at sea. And so I kind of got my wits together. When I got turned around and started crawling, the leg followed. I thought I'd completely lost my leg almost. But my leg kind of followed along, and I said, I think maybe it's all right, other than it busted up. So I tried to crawl across the deck, and the metal, big pieces, little pieces, were just, it was red hot. But I knew I had to get it under cover. So I crawled over under the cover there. My hands were all burnt and everything from, you know, red hot metal. But I crawled over under there. And then I guess I passed out.
If it wouldn't have been called up, that I got called up because that one gun wasn't working, I wouldn't have been up on topside. I would have been downstairs by my bunk. But, well, duty calls, you go.
The dead were stacked up in corners out of the way. And about, as I recall, 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, it was time to commit those dead to the deep. And they went down to the lunchroom and got about 20 lunch tables with collapsible legs. They laid them open space on the deck, not too far from the lifelines. Just about much space between each one. They sent out a working party to bring up a body, put on a table. And then when they got one on each table with a mattress cover over them, the chaplain would raise his hand, say a short prayer, and then at each end, four able-bodied men, with two on each side of a table, would reach down, pick it up, and go sideways to the rail and raise one end up. And body would slide off into the deep. Did that for 220 some at night.
We had to carry the dead, a lot of them, back to the fantail. And after we got them all back there, they had funeral. I helped put them over the side.
Well, I think the first thing was when I got noticed he'd been wounded. And then got checking around and checking with some of the other wives, you know. And that's the way I found out that that was the incident. And Perk said he was on the quarter deck. He and a couple of guys was watching somebody else, what they were doing. And those two guys just were blown to pieces. And he wondered all his life why he was saved. He was the only one that got off of the quarter deck that time.
Okinawa, what was the next operation? And this, we're now talking about April of 45. That was, in many respects, one of the
toughest campaigns for the Navy. We lost more people in that operation than any other because of the kamikazes.
We were standing out on the deck. I heard a plane, and I looked up, and here he was, right smack above us, coming down. Get right in front of the bridge and went right down through the officers' quarters and through the sick bay and killed everybody. And the bomb went down to the armor deck and blew outside the ship. And that's how it got flooded so bad.
That's when I looked up and saw the suicide plane, and he was just straight down. He went for the bridge and missed the bridge by about 5 feet and hit main deck on the starboard side. And he had a 500-pound bomb on him. And when he crashed through the first main deck, he kept on going down three decks and the bomb blew up. We lost 49 men that day, and four were missing and 89 were wounded. There was a Marine, and he was on a 20-millimeter gun, and he was shooting, and he was knocking chunks out of the wing of that plane, big as daylight. It was just scattering holes in him, you know. And that's what got him off course. He would have hit the bridge had he not been shot at by this Marine. And he stayed on that gun while that ship, I mean, that plane was right over his head. And he stayed with it. Then he jumped down the hole and saved some guys that carried him out bodily. He was pretty strong man.
I heard the 20 millimeters going off. Well, they're very short range, and when you're shooting 20 millimeters, something must be right on top of you. And so I ran down the passageway, pulled the watertight door shut behind me. Well, the plane hit just a few feet the other side of that door. I couldn't see it, of course, but it came straight down. And about 50-some were killed, and most of them were in sick bay.
I was covered from the mess hall for some reason, but I don't remember why, and I was headed for my bunk, which is in the 1st Division. And that's where the bomb went off. It's in the 1st Division. So I thanked the dear Lord many a times that I didn't make it to my bunk, because I wouldn't be here today.
And our whole area was engulfed in flame. And my instinctive reaction took over, and I dashed out of there through the burning part of the ship. My roommate didn't get out, and that haunts me to this day.
We buried 27 out at sea on the way to Guam. You know how they do that? You slip them off, and the taps.
You know, that's when the real reality hit me then. You know, because I didn't want to go back out. I was very apprehensive, And you know, shucks, I'm only on this thing for a short period of time, and I can imagine what these guys that have been on that thing since it was commissioned. You know, what they've been through, and then going back out and getting smacked again.
The ship was commissioned in 43. It was hit in 43, 44, and 45, and decommissioned in 46. And it was quite a gallant ship. Almost unlucky, but then again, it was a great ship. And I had a lot of old memories on that ship.
They were wonderful people. And they were very exciting, dramatic things to live through, but being part of that enormous fleet, I knew that there'd never be a fleet like that again in history. So I felt that I was a part of history, and I was damn glad that I survived it.
You have great things in your life. One of the greatest things I ever had is when I got out of the service, got out of that taxi cab, and my wife and that baby was standing in the back door. That's the greatest thing that ever in my life had ever happened.
I made it. A lot of them didn't.
It was rough.
I was darn lucky. Because a lot of those guys I knew were killed. We won by sure numbers, blood and guts.
We helped save our liberty, preserve our liberty. I still think it's the best thing I've ever done in my life.